I'm going to talk about this European project under Horizon 2020 that we finalized in March this year. And it's been a hardworking project with really a good group of people. So some of them are also here. So the challenge, as we know, physical inactivity is a challenge at old age. And we also know that activity level drops significantly when people retire. And what we also know is that uptake and adherence of traditional intervention is a challenge. People go back to their original activity level once an intervention is finished. And we also know that we need to empower people to stay healthy longer for the future. So what we focused on in this project was how can technology support active, healthy living at old age? And I will focus on exercise as one of the domains that Marlene has talked about earlier. So we use smartphones, and smartphone is what we call a mobile health technology. And mobile health technology focuses on delivery on health services via mobile or wireless health communication systems and platforms. And you can say that mHealth offers new solution for the delivery of health services on distances. It might include self-monitoring and assessment. It might include interventions, and it also gives the opportunity to give more or less immediate feedback on what the person is doing. As we all know, there is a plethora of applications out there, most of them in the fitness field. But there are also some systems that have been developed for healthcare in particular. But what we also know is that few are evidence-based. There is very little knowledge about uptake over time. And there is also a challenge that few have been made particularly for older people. So in the Prevent-It project, we wanted to use a smartphone as a coach for intervention. And our target group was inactive people between 60 and 70 years of age. So the idea was to find those at risk of functional decline before they really had decline in function and add an intervention to make them stay active and healthy. And we also use self-assessment tools, and we also develop prediction tools for functional decline for risk assessment. I won't go into that, but focus on the intervention now. And to make, it's not an easy task to make an application, a mobile health application. You also need a server or a place to store and process the information. So we established a cloud-based server where we process the information regarding what people actually did with the application, what kind of exercises they did, and also we could give individualized feedback back on depending what they reported on they were doing. We also wanted to... That's in the middle? Okay, didn't work. To the right, there is a network of users, so we also wanted people to be able to connect. That didn't show up to be very... helpful, or people didn't use that option, so I won't talk about that either, but it's an important aspect to work on in the future. We also connected the smartphone with a smartwatch because people are not always wearing a smartphone, so when people didn't wear the smartphone on the body, we registered activity by the smartwatch. So we developed the system using a user-centered design development process with the user in the loop in all phases of the development. So we did a pilot study on the development of the intervention. We also did a pilot study on the usability and acceptability of the technology. And the main study in this project was a feasibility trial on the entire system. So that's what I'm going to talk about. For the intervention, we used an intervention developed in Australia by Lindy Clemson. And that's the LIFE intervention. And maybe someone you listened to, Michael Schwenk, yesterday, he was talking about the LIFE intervention as a group intervention. What is special with the LIFE intervention is that it's not an exercise intervention per se. It is an activity intervention where you challenge yourself in the task you are doing in your own lives. So you find opportunities in your own life so where you can challenge, for example, balance and muscle strength and activity more. So you don't put time away to do exercise. You integrate it into your own life. And this intervention has shown to be effective in preventing falls in older people 75 years and older. So that was a starting point. But our population was 60 to 70 years of age. So we had to adapt the exercise. So we developed an exercise database. And we also in the LIFE concept, there is a focus on behavioral change, and that we also used in our study and also strengthened that part. So once we had developed this exercise database, we also transferred that to a digital platform so people could use the mobile phone to do the intervention. And we developed the exercise or activities at different difficulty levels, and included balance, strengthening exercise, and also physical activity, and to reduce sedentary behavior. So to tailor the intervention, we use people's own goals, long-term goals as a starting point. And we also had to determine the starting level. So then we used the tools from the LIFE intervention. We had the schedule over the week, and so people could identify when in their life and which situations they wanted to, could do some extra on to work on balance and muscle strength, and also increase their activity and reduce their sedentary time. So, for example, one situation could be cooking dinner. And then one person could choose, for example, to stand on one leg while cooking dinner. So that's one example, and that was then marked in his personal schedule. Or another person could use the opportunity to walk a bit more while visiting families, by getting off the bus, for example, one station before he usually did. So these are just examples. So we developed an application where one panel was about the messages and the feedback that people got. So that was personalized feedback based on their own goals and also the exercises they chose to do. And then we suggested activities for them based on their phenotype. So we had checked that before we started. But they were also able to choose activities themselves as those proposed activities. And here is the panel where the people set their own goals. And also a panel where they could have a look at their own achievements during the day and also over longer periods. So for the physical activity, that was automatically uploaded based on the monitoring of the activity from the smartwatch and the smartphone, while the performance or the balance and strength activities was based on feedback that people gave whether they had done their exercises or not. So just to show you how the application works. So this is the message panel, and you could get feedback on, you ask why you did or didn't do your exercises, and there's always a positive feedback on, motivating feedback. So here are two exercises proposed by the app, but the person can also choose activities by him or herself and to have a look at how the exercise looked like at that difficulty level he had chosen. So this is a launch at the level two. It's a 4 meter launch. And this is also in another, how you could do it in another situation during walking. And then you could also add this to come on top of your list of prioritized activities. So I'll just skip that. So we did a feasibility study to where we compared this digital intervention with the same intervention delivered on paper format, and also to a group who were just asked to follow the WHO advices on physical activity. So it was a 6 month active intervention, and then people were left with the app or the intervention schedule and perform it by themselves for the next 6 months. And we did this study in three European sites. And those who attended should be retired or at least work less than 50% and not exercise more than once a week, because we wanted those who were more inactive. And that's not easy to get, because it's always so that the more active people want to take part. So these are the interventions. So it was the eLife, that's a digital intervention. For that, they were offered 4 home visits and 3 phone calls, and that was also to learn to use the technology. Most of our users had the smartphone from before, but it was also some few that didn't have that. And the paper-based intervention, for that intervention, we followed more or less the protocol from Lindy Clemson. So they got 6 home visits and 3 phone calls. And the control group was left with a form with the guidelines. So 52% of those attending were women. Mean age was 66. They had a mean gait speed of 1.4 meters per second, which is quite high. And MoCA score for the assessment of cognitive function on 27 out of 30 points. So that's also quite good. So for the adherence to the intervention, so for full adherence, that was related to what people had said they would do on their own schedule. So when comparing the eLife and the aLife, there were not large differences between the two groups. So delivering this by the digital solution gave as good adherence as for the paper-based version. And we were, because we also had this cloud-based server collecting all the information, we were also able to see how much people use the app. So this is 365 days where the intervention was done. This is Amsterdam, Stuttgart, and Trondheim. And as you can see, all the circles is each individual using the app over the time. So what you can see is that there was a lot of people who actually used the app also after the 6 months. And the average day of use was 180 out of 365, and it was a range from 1 to 360 days. And you might wonder what was the vertical open spaces, and that was the 2 days the server was done. So the the activities that people selected, on top of that list was squatting, lunging, walking on toes, stair climbing, and sit to stand. That's for the strengthening part. For the balance, it was tandem stance, one leg stance, and tandem walk. And for physical activity, the most popular one was breaking up sitting, not, for example, walking faster. So that says something also about how much people maybe wanted to challenge themselves. We also asked whether people integrated their, if they thought they had integrated their activities into their daily routines. And there was no difference between the eLife and the aLife. T2 means that that's the time when we ended the intervention, and T3 is 6 months later. So out of 60 people, more than half said that they had integrated these activities in the daily routine. And that was a main goal for us also to have this behavioral change. So to summarize, what we found is that it is feasible to include a large population of younger adults and to roll out the eLife intervention. And also participants across the three arms liked the concept. That was also for the control group, because they had a lot of follow-ups and assessments, and they thought their perception was also that they had had an active intervention. And adherence was good, despite the technology was a bit immature, because we had only 1 year to develop everything. So there were some technical problems. And what was also positive is that the habits that were formed at 6 months were largely retained at 12 months. Most people were active and quite well functioning, and that gave some problems for a ceiling effect on the assessment tools that we used. It was a new group for us, the population of 60 to 70 years old. We had very little experience with that, and we thought we had chosen good outcome measures for function, but it was a challenge anyway. I didn't show you the results here, but and the study was not powered either to detect differences between people, but all groups improved, and there was a lack of significant differences between groups. But it was a feasibility study, and overall, the eLife concept demonstrated acceptable usability and feasibility. So our take-home message here is that mobile health technology is accepted among young seniors, and that it is feasible to use the smartphone as a coach to improve physical activity and function. And we didn't assess faults particularly, but the intervention we used developed to reduce faults. So that was it. Thank you.